James B. Madonna, and the Reverend Dr. William J. Eisenman.
All right. That's it. All right, people? Staff, everything okay? Cameraman, everything all right? All right, good.
Ready to roll.
Ready to roll, man.
Yes, I got a haircut. I got them all cut, actually. It's an old cheesy joke.
That's great.
seven lucky bells for our show for this week's progressive discussions. Okay. I just want to say, before I begin, might as well get the formalities out of the way. Well, you already know who we are and where we're from because you saw the intro. Everything we discuss politically is part of our series, Capitalism in a Conch Shell. Actually, Crapitalism. Crapitalism in a Conch Shell. Yeah. See that conch? Messages from King Neptune. You got too much to say that will take up too much of our time, right, King? Yeah, I know how it is. Oh, yeah, Donald Trump. Yeah, you think that's that if someday he might undergo a psychiatric evaluation? What? Straitjacket? Yikes. I think so. Look good, that's for sure.
That's for sure.
That's for damn sure. Okay. Yeah, right-wing evangelists, religious freaks. Yes. Yeah, we know all about them. They're out of their minds, man. They're completely out of their minds, and they can't prove anything. No wonder our forefathers wanted to keep church and state completely separated. That's right. All right, I'll talk to you later. All right, gotta love that Neptune. Or what the Greeks used to call him, Poseidon. Not Poseidon. Now you're talking about Donald Trump again. Poseidon. Pee-pee, no more pee-pee-pee. I can't wait to see what Alec Baldwin does tonight. On Saturday Night Live. He's got such a great job for the next 4 years, that Alec Baldwin. Alright, okay. Now, you remember that gentleman, Stephen from New Jersey, that had problems with social services, with New Jersey welfare, and then he got that straightened out, and then he applied for Social Security disability, and then he got jerked around by them, and then eventually he got that straightened out because he had legal representation and he won his case. Way to go, Steve.
Yay.
I mean, they're not giving him a fortune, but you know, they are giving him a nice retroactive check.
I hope so.
They are giving him a nice retro check. The monthly payment is like ballpark typical of what people get on Social Security disability. I mean, it's still, you know, Social Security disability payments is like the average American salary. The average pay in this wonderful, hold on. And it's wonderful capitalism we have here in America. You know, here's the cost of living, and here's the average American salary. Here's the cost of living, and here's the typical Social Security disability payment. Down here. Okay, here's the cost of living, and I don't know if you can see, all the way down here is what welfare gives poor people. New Jersey fucking welfare, all the way down here. So, the cost of living is always head over heels, far above the typical American salary, the typical welfare payments, and the typical Social Security disability.
Because they always cheat on the COLA.
Big business screws the customer every chance they get. They lie to you. So why not, you know, hey, the people that are in bed with the big companies are the same people that screw you out of what you should be receiving. Now, on the other hand, In Scandinavia, they're starting to give people an annual base income. A couple countries have started. I think Norway started it. And a base income gives you, gives every citizen the foundation that they need to have a halfway decent, a halfway decent semi-happy life, maybe a happy life. You know, I mean, you only live once. Life is short, and if you got a miserable life, that's pretty depressing, because then it'll be like the fruit fly. You know, you're born, you hang around a little bit, you have sex, and then you drop dead. You know, like creatures with short telomeres. Mm-hmm. Rats live 3 years, you know. So humans, I mean, pets in general, they live 10, 15, 20 years. Humans, you might squeeze 80 years out of them under good conditions, maybe more. You know, I'm talking, well, we're not talking about a very sickly old age. We're talking about quality life here.
Yeah.
You know, so, like, you know, your Jack LaLanne's out there. So, but eventually, time flies, and it's time to croak. So, at least you should be happy. So, you got that, you got that base salary. Now, Stephen, let's get back to Stephen. All right. He won his case. Way to go, Steve. All right. Retro is good. He's very happy. Retro is actually great. Monthly payments are good. I wouldn't say they're bad. I wouldn't say they're poor. But, you know, still, realistically, cost of living's up here. Average Social Security disability payment is right down over here. Mm-hmm. Now, especially with the major cities of the U.S., with the cost of rents and everything, You know, everything's a ripoff in capitalist America. Everything, utility bills, cable, you name it, hooker by crook, you name it, they're all crooked. Now, what Stephen found out that really pissed him off, and he called me, is that, okay, now that he has the Social Security disability, they threw him off his Obamacare, his Horizon of New Jersey Affordable Care Act, whatever. They threw him off that. Now he's got a Medicare card. Okay, of course they have to take Medicare premiums from his original Social Security disability amount.
That's correct.
I mean,
however,
heaven forbid.
Huh? You may contact SLMB Jersey, and you might be
eligible
for them to, for the state of New Jersey to pay that. They will pay that.
Write that down before I leave, and I will give it to Stephen. SLM, okay, all right.
SLMB.
I will try very hard to remind you. All right.
Low income.
Right. Now, I don't know, listen, I don't know if Stephen still has an active Medicaid card, because Medicaid was attached to the Obamacare. You have a feeling he got booted off of that.
Yeah.
Okay. Because like my mother has her Social Security retirement check.
Yeah.
She has her health insurance called WellCare that works with Medicare. She has that, and she said she has Medicaid. Now, I don't understand how my mother has all that.
Right.
And Stephen has a guts angulo.
Well, you can look into all of that.
Yeah, I mean, you know. So we got to look. Steve, you got to look into it. I will help you out because, oh, this is why Stephen was pissed. He calls Medicare. Medicare says, well, you have to sign up for a prescription drug plan.
Part B.
Yeah, he says, all right, give me the policies. What's your cheapest? What's your lowest rate? She brings up all the companies. She says, well, the lowest rate that will pay for the medications you're taking, because, you know, you don't want to, there's no sense of going rock bottom and then end up paying more out of pocket when you go to the pharmacist. because then you're not really saving. If you're paying a higher, what's the word, copay.
Copay.
Then, you know, you gotta have a plan that'll cover your costs.
Well, that is also another New Jersey plan. It's called PAAD, P-A-A-D. And okay. It will pay for a company, and the company they're using right now is called SilverScript.
You get
a Part D card, SilverScript, that pays your drug costs.
Now, this applies to Social Security disability recipients?
Low-income people. Any low income.
Right, but you got to be within their...
It's New Jersey now, not federal.
But you got to be within their range, they consider...
But it's a pretty good range, you know, it's okay. If I think it's you got to be making something like $21,000.
Well, Medicaid, I think, is cut off if you're making up to $800-some-odd a month.
Yeah.
You're eligible if you fall under that amount. You know, then the Medicaid.
This is much different.
Yeah.
Better. Yeah. It's much better.
Yeah. Well, actually, remind me, I'll write them down. Yeah. Now, the lowest practical drug prescription coverage is a company called First Health, and it's $35 a month. That Steven says, isn't that a little steep?
Well, normally, if you didn't have PAD, you'd pay $30 a month. Or ARP or one of the other companies that carry the cards. Yeah.
I don't understand why the girl from Medicare didn't mention all these things.
You're over 50.
No, Steven. I mean, Steven.
Steve is over 50.
Yes, sir.
So he should join ARP too. It's only $12 a year.
Well, that's just a membership, like dues, right?
Yeah.
Like dues.
But you learn stuff, it's part of being old.
They sell vitamins. Well, so I guess they consider over 50 to be old.
Yes.
see, the reason why Stephen got approved for Social Security disability so easily, is because he turned 55 at the right year, which means he doesn't have to prove if he's eligible for any other occupation. Aside from what he did in life, like if he was younger, if he didn't turn 55 at that certain year, they would have to analyze the judge and they have vocational experts, so to speak. They will analyze to see if Stephen is eligible for any other occupation. Aside from the fact that the job market is shit, you know, they would do that. They would try to let's see what else Stephen can do for a living, you know, and use that as an excuse not to give him Social Security disability.
Yes.
But if you're a Republican congressman or whatever, and you got rich buddies, and you got, you got corporations getting free billions in free welfare, oh, money is no object when it comes to that. On the show Mysteries of the Museum, they showed up a bunker with thick, thick lead walls, a bunker that was built under a hotel in Virginia, outskirts of Virginia. Not terribly far from Washington, D.C., but, you know, not next door either, but it's a bunker. It's in the country, and no one knew it was there, and the government declassified it, I think, in 1992, early 90s, declassified it. Mm-hmm. So it's now open for the public to see, and it looked like a fortune was put into this bunker because... It is supposed to comfortably contain the Senate and the House of Representatives comfortably
in case,
you know, a nuclear attack. Now it was a beautiful. It almost looked like a village or a town underground, and And why would they spend all that money, then declassify it? All, I'm sure taxpayers' money went into...
Because they got another one, that's why.
Yeah, but more up, but they date. Already have one. Don't they think about the taxpayers?
Hey, who is this guy?
Who, me?
Yeah, who came in here?
I don't know. Who's behind me? Are you being sarcastic?
Jesus, my God.
You're being sarcastic.
Think about the taxpayer.
Well, I mean, Reverend Dr. Bill, this bunker was freaking enormous. It had a theater. It had a...
Yeah.
Oh, it had a room for the House of Representatives to have meetings. It had little apartments. It had a kitchen. It had...
There's one in Nevada or Utah or whatever.
Why the fuck couldn't
in
they...
In the mountain.
Why couldn't they continue to use this? It's beautiful. You know, you spent the money. It's gorgeous. Use it. Why declassify it? You know what? See, the problem is the American people... and really no one else holds any politician accountable for any damn thing once they're elected. That's it. That's the problem. They're not answering to anybody.
What about the weapons and et cetera? The tanks, a couple of years ago, you just threw them away and bought new ones.
Talk about military waste.
Yeah. It's terrific.
Listen, military, social services... And I know I keep on repeating myself. Social services make up 1-2% of the total budget. The military makes up over 50% of the total budget. Now, that's not counting the waste.
Oh, come on.
You know, the waste, no, the waste is included.
Built in.
Now, if the waste wasn't there, you know, the conservatives that are supposed to be conservative with spending, unless it's on themselves and their family and their friends. You know, I mean, it would be considerably less than the 56 or 55% of the total budget.
Which it doesn't need to be in the first place.
Yeah.
Because if we just spent normally, we still spend more than any other... than any other bunch of countries combined.
Oh, without a doubt. Yeah, Mitch McConnell, he sounds like Jimmy Stewart.
Oh, American people, I can stand for it.
He's full of shit. American people have no idea what you and your crooked friends are doing.
Uh-huh.
No idea, and they're not going to stand for it. Yeah. You know, turtle face. The point is that they just are not held accountable. They are free to do whatever they want, and they do it. I mean, but when it comes to the little guy, you don't deserve a penny.
Mm-mm.
The little guy deserves not one red cent.
Nothing.
According to a Republican politician.
Right. And
you're going to see a cute banner when we go to lunch. It says, like, if Jesus was born 30 years ago...
How many?
If Jesus was born only 30 years ago,
okay.
The Republicans and Fox News would have him pegged as a Middle Eastern terrorist, enabling the poor, socialist, the commie pinko, etc., etc., etc. They would have Jesus labeled as that. The so forget about when a right wing evangelical brags about how close to God they are. It's all a complete lie, because they don't know the God of the Bible. They don't want to help the poor. All right, they don't want to pay their fair share in taxes. But what puzzles me are all the morons that believe their propaganda, and these morons are living paycheck to paycheck, bill to bill, week to week, month to month. Some of them don't have a pot to piss in, and they vote Republican.
You saw it in Kentucky with this election, with Trump.
Yeah, the
everybody on Obamacare and Medicaid and this, that, and the other thing voted for Trump.
Yeah, there was a funny cartoon of a redneck saying, "I don't want nothing to do with no Obamacare." Oh, no, we have the Affordable Care Act. Oh, that sounds good.
Yeah, that's what they did. They went around the street and they asked people, Do you favor Obamacare, or would you favor something like the Affordable Care Act? The Affordable Care Act. Everyone, they don't know what the hell they're talking about.
I don't want no stinking old bummer care.
That's the problem. There's like 35% of America, they consider themselves conservatives.
Well, they're...
who don't know what the hell they're voting for or doing.
Well, they're clueless.
Clueless.
They're completely clueless. Yeah. Chiseler's Hall of Shame, of course. Shame on you, American pharmaceutical industry. Shame on you, American insurance companies. Steve shouldn't have to be paying no stinking $35 a month from his Social Security
disability. Thanks to George W. Bush. Part D is thanks to George W. Bush.
Right. Now, of course, the universal single-payer...
too easy.
Modified
too
Medicare.
Easy.
But that's
too easy.
Anything that makes sense.
Yeah.
You see, to all the people that are clueless, really, efficient living and doing the right thing is really just common sense. You don't have to be a rocket scientist, or you don't have to have a high IQ. You don't even need you don't have to be brilliant to know who to vote for. You just vote for who has your best interests. That's all you have
Bingo.
To do. It's as simple as that.
Bingo.
All right, let us sink our teeth into these readings for this week's Progressive Discussions. And we've been getting a lot of attacks by trolls lately, but that's okay. It just invigorates me. You know, what's a shame? My Blackthorn Shillelagh hasn't really cracked open the heads.
Well, why don't you ask
of anyone yet since I've had this?
Why don't you ask them if they want to take over the show?
No, it's not about the show.
Oh.
I don't even care anymore what
it's about time.
What people say about the show, because I like the way we do things here. But you know, it's about other things like in other words, to make a long story short. If you're an outspoken person and you call them like you see them, you're open for attack.
That's correct. And that's in any society.
Yeah. So there's an old African proverb is that a person who tells the truth all the time that has no friends or very few. You know, George Carlin says people really appreciate honesty until you say something about them.
Exactly.
Then you're an asshole.
And that's honest. Yeah.
So how honest could? It's hypocritical. You want honesty, but whoa, as long as you don't mention my name.
Yeah.
All right, go ahead.
Article on woman's reproductive rights challenged.
All right, sounds good.
About halfway through the editorial, I stopped and settled on, but the choice to abort or not abort should be made by women, not the federal government. But guess who gave them that choice? If the liberal majority on the U.S. Supreme Court still had a moral backbone, it wouldn't help women kill their own soon-to-be-born children.
Kill? So they consider the embryo and the fertilized egg to be a human baby.
Human baby.
Now, they're wrong. It's no more a human baby than the eggs in my omelet or an acorn. You know what an acorn is?
Yeah.
To an oak tree. An acorn is to an oak tree. It is no more a baby.
President John Adams said, "Our Constitution was made only for a moral and a religious people." James Wilson, original Supreme Court Justice, said, "Human law must rest its authority ultimately upon the authority of that law which is divine." Washington, Madison, some of the other founding fathers were of the same mind. They did not intend for God to be trapped within the four walls of a church. And the Catholic Church is the largest private charity organization in the world. The financial charity of this church preserves all life in the womb.
Yeah, well, let me tell you, most charities are scams. Even if you tell me 25 cents on a dollar goes to the worthy cause, I still consider that a scam, because the people that work for charities should do it on volunteer basis. So the only charity I respect is St. Jude's Children's Hospital, and I was appalled by the people that collect donated hair, charge cancer children, cancer patient children for the wig, charge them.
I would like to see Uncle Sam equal the Catholic Church in this effort.
Huh. Well, the Catholic Church, I hear, has many billions in gold. Bullion, right?
Oh, yeah.
In gold.
Oh, yeah.
So, half of that can eradicate poverty worldwide. So, you know, you represent the God of the Bible? Well, liquidate some of them assets and eradicate poverty.
Well, you see what Jesus told the one rich guy when he asked what he could do.
Yeah.
He said, give all of that away. He couldn't do that.
Give it to the poor and then come and follow me.
Yeah.
He couldn't do it.
He couldn't do that.
Hey, Donald Trump's wonderful wall would cost about, $20 billion?
Anywhere from 17 to 20 billion.
That'll eradicate poverty in the United States and homelessness, but no problem. You know, but that makes too much sense.
Well, yeah.
That makes too much sense.
And believe it or not, for that wall, if it ever gets built, and when it gets built, the taxpayers will pay for it.
Of course, not the rich.
But there are places in that wall that must remain see-through. They cannot be solid over some of the areas it's planned to go through.
Yeah, let's take El Paso, Texas, which is right next to Juarez, the very dangerous Juarez, Mexico.
Mm-hmm.
There's a road there. There's a road. People enter Mexico and the U.S. via that path. That little bridge that goes over the Rio Grande, if there's anything left of the Rio Grande River.
Yeah.
Probably like a semi... probably
a little
like,
rivulet this time of year, maybe.
Yeah, like it's mostly a skeleton,
yeah.
The Rio Grande. So, you know, some place has to be open, but hey, they found a very lovely modern tunnel going from San Diego to Tijuana, Mexico.
Yes.
Built by Mexicans.
Yep.
Really nice tunnel, and it was quite lovely. You know, you could make a very nice studio apartment down there. You won't even need air conditioning. And
had it.
Don't tunnels go under walls?
Because El Chapo's tunnel had air conditioning.
Oh well, yeah, but when he built some, it's top of the line. It's second to none. It's the best. What I'm saying is tunnels go on the walls.
Yeah, and the helicopters and planes fly over them. Or catapults, even.
The catapult.
Hey, the guy in the circus does it with the cannon, no?
And you're making
so me... So what the hell? We catapult something.
And you're making
there.
Me think of some old British comedy on Monty Python.
Monty Python, yeah.
You know, catapult them over the wall.
There you go. President Donald Trump is taking his first steps aimed at scaling back financial services regulations. And the Republican-run Congress cast a vote early on Friday, signaling that it's eager to help. The president signed an executive order that will direct the Treasury Secretary to review a 2010 financial oversight law, which reshaped financial regulation after the 2008-2009 financial crisis. Trump! Also signed a presidential memorandum that instructs the Labor Department to delay implementing an Obama-era rule that requires financial professionals who charge commissions to put their clients' best interests first when giving advice on retirement investments. The order won't have any immediate impact. The administration's intent is clear. Any relaxation of the burdensome regulations will be greatly appreciated by the bank. Gerald Lipkin, Chairman and Chief Executive Officer of Valley National Bank, said in a statement. John McWheeney, Jr., President and CEO of the New Jersey Bankers Association, said his industry is not looking to be regulated. We're just looking for some smart regulation that allows banks to serve their customers better.
I wonder if he looks like Anthony Weiner. He's Mr. McWheeney.
Anyway. Phyllis Salau K, Executive Director of New Jersey Citizen Action in Newark, bemoaned the effort to scale back the Dodd-Frank amendment. We worked so hard, as did our members and our affiliated organizations, to get Dodd-Frank passed, she said. It would be absolutely tragic to see Dodd-Frank rolled back. This is the first significant financial reform that we've seen, and coming off the 2008 disaster that affected so many people, it's just another example of Wall Street winning over Main Street, and we can't let that happen. We will fight to protect Wall Street reform and the highly successful Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, the agency at the front lines of consumer protection that has been targeted by big Wall Street banks, debt collectors, and even payday lenders, because it works for consumers and not for them. Ed Mirzwinski, Consumer Program Director for the Public Research Interest Group, said in a statement, Trump pledged during his campaign to repeal and replace the Dodd-Frank law, which also created the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau. Dodd-Frank is a disaster, Trump said earlier this week during a meeting with small business owners. We're going to be doing a big number on Dodd-Frank.
So how's he going to help small businesses if he wants to cut more taxes from the rich?
Obviously, those people are not asking that part of the question.
Because small businesses, you see, when you hear the word Main Street, that's the middle class. And what is the middle class? Unions, union members, small businesses, mom and pop stores, professionals, self-employed professionals, these are all part of Main Street, middle class. You take away small businesses and unions and all that stuff, you're destroying the middle class. And oh, by the way, the middle class are the backbone consumers for the economy. They are the backbone for jobs and for the economy. Consumer spending.
Yeah.
You know, hey, any readings on, what's her name, Kellyanne Conway?
Yes.
Kellyanne Conway?
Yes. She made a big boo-boo the other day.
Oh, she did? All right, continue.
The shorthand name for the law refers to its Democratic sponsors, former Senator Chris Dodd of Connecticut and former Representative Barney Frank of Massachusetts. Trump's order won't have any immediate impact, but it directs the Treasury Secretary to consult with members of different regulatory agencies and the Financial Stability Oversight Council and report back on potential changes. Trump administration officials, like other critics, argue Dodd-Frank did not achieve what it set out to do and portray it as an example of massive government overreach.
Okay. Oh, time for my medicinal tea. Oh.
My medicinal tea. Let me see if I can find that one on Kellyanne
Conway?
Yeah.
What a joke that outfit was, huh? During the inauguration that she wore. She looked like a Revolutionary War soldier in a dress uniform for a parade or something.
Yeah.
So ridiculous. You know, these Republicans, they sure are very ostentatious about their so-called patriotism, aren't they?
Yeah, because Republicans are more patriotic.
And they're more godly.
That's right.
God likes them better than anyone else. Meanwhile, they'll let the poor starve in the street.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, great Christians, right?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. You know, and then you got your evangelical mega churches. When's the last time they helped the poor? Like Joel Osteen in his mansion? They always look constipated when they pray. Remember Ted Cruz, his eyes were squinted, he's making that face, you know, his hands are up in the air like he's like it's a Wi-Fi antenna to God, you know?
Seems to me a
bat phone. They got a bat phone to God. Oh, yeah. Mysteries of the museum, they said. They were talking about how the White House was at the beginning, and it was structurally, there were structural flaws in it.
Oh.
And presidents did different things with it. I think Teddy Roosevelt did the biggest renovation, and he's the one that had put the structural flaw in it. But then they showed how different presidents had the Oval Office set up. But there wasn't an Oval Office until FDR. There was the Oval Office today was, I think, established by Franklin Roosevelt, and what was I going to say about the? I lost my train of thought.
Choo-choo!
I was going to say something about the White House or about Mysteries of the Museum. During the Cold War, there was no red phone JFK can call Nikita Khrushchev. There was no hotline. There was a teletyper, like a telegraph. Yeah, there was no red phone. I think that's where they got the idea for the Batman series with Adam West. Remember Commissioner Gordon
and
Chief O'Hara had a red phone?
Yeah. All the police he had working for me, he got to call Batman.
Well, they never did anything. The Gotham City Police Department never did a damn thing. They would bother Batman for everything. they shine that light in the sky.
Yeah.
Well, wait a minute. If they call him on the bat phone, why did it have to shine the Batman spotlight in the sky?
I have no idea.
To make sure. I mean, maybe it's that way. That's if Batman wasn't home. If he wasn't in the Batcave, then Alfred couldn't answer it.
Yeah.
You know, you gotta love the old comedies, especially if they're low budget.
I can't seem to find Kellyanne here.
And Maybe the reading doesn't exist.
No, it exists here, but it's probably among another one. You know?
Maybe it stucketh to something else.
Elseth, yeah.
Elseth.
But I'm...
All right, don't worry about
it. I'm down to older readings, and that's...
Well, you want, yeah, you want older readings that are still applicable to today.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, they should be applicable to the week.
Yeah.
The week of the show, which is this week.
Some things are more eternal than that, and they are...
Well, some things have a...
They are week to week.
Some readings have a universal message.
Right. Or they can be any week. You know, even several weeks old.
Hey, I know some of your readings of censored were eternal. Many of them were.
That's correct.
The names are different. Sir. The names may be different. The presidents may be different. But the message and the problems are still the same.
Right on.
That's what we mean by a universal subject.
Right on. Okay.
Well, read something, you know, I mean, not ancient, but read something.
President Donald Trump, while speaking at the annual National Prayer Breakfast...
Oh, yeah, I heard about that.
...in Washington on Thursday, asked America...
He's a man...
...to pray for Arnold Schwarzenegger.
Why, he's sick? Arnold's sick? No, don't tell me.
And his sagging ratings since taking over the Celebrity Apprentice.
Oh, I hear they're having words with each other.
Trump had been introduced by Mark Burnett, who produced and created the original The Apprentice.
He's mad because he can't do both.
And the celebrity spinoff, The President's Remark, was a small part of his speech. It should be taken in context, not just how it fit into a bipartisan gathering of political leaders that should have been more reflective.
I think Arnold Schwarzenegger said, hey, Trump, let's switch jobs.
He did. And then we'll see our ratings.
And you know what? I think Arnold's ratings would be very favorable over a Donald Trump.
As in soul-searching rather than mirror preening, but how it follows the president's statement on National Holocaust Remembrance Day last week, that was the same day Trump signed an executive order banning all refugees from entering the United States for 120 days.
All refugees, meaning not just Muslim, all refugees. Or does he really mean
Muslims? From those seven countries.
Yeah, except the countries he's doing business with.
Of course, none of those countries ever sent us the terrorists, though.
No.
Trump did not specifically mention Jews in his Holocaust statement. Apologies are not his style. So on Saturday, White House spokesman Hope Hicks, responding to criticism of the statement, was on CNN, saying, "Despite what the media reports, we are an incredibly inclusive group, and we took into account all those who suffered." Not good enough. The Nazis killed millions of people, including gypsies and homosexuals. But the Holocaust was a Jewish tragedy. The final solution was designed to exterminate Jews, young and old, regardless of politics or wealth or anything save the fact that they were Jews.
Well, I heard a young George Soros, his job was to confiscate the personal belongings of the Jews before they went on the train to the concentration camp, you know,
possibly,
they confiscated everything they had.
6 million Jews were killed. And while Jews were being rounded up into cattle cars and sent to work in camps and gas chambers, the United States did little to save them.
Well, they turned away German Jews. Most, yeah. Seeking asylum on a ship, on a passenger ship. The passenger ship had to return to Germany.
The absence of Jews in the Holocaust statement perhaps was a sign of the lack of people with wisdom around the president. Some reports suggest that Trump's son-in-law, Jared Kushner, the grandson of Holocaust survivors, had a hand in writing the statement. I do not question Kushner's faith. I do question whether any 30-something person has the first generation connection needed to understand why the absence of Jew in the statement was so significant. Holocaust survivors are dying out. The young men and women who witnessed the rise of the Nazis and fled for their lives are upwards of 90 years old now.
Oh yeah, and people who survived Stalin, Joseph Stalin also, Jews were also killed, Russian Jews in Ukraine were also killed by the Nazis. Yeah. But people forget history. People have a tendency to forget history.
That's what he means there, there won't be anyone around to describe it and say that it actually happened. Yeah. Well, they'll be like the president of Iran a while ago, who never believed in it.
What about, you don't even have to go to Nazi Germany. What about the Native Americans and the slaves, the African slaves in the United States? I mean, they were tortured. There was, genocide, torture.
Yes.
You know, I mean, but you know, the younger generations quickly
forget.
They don't even think about it.
No, of course not.
So they cannot have the empathy. If there are no survivors left, they cannot read. I mean, they should really read real history books, but I don't think there's any out there in school. But, you know, if there is, there should be empathy.
If they don't come from Texas, I would trust them.
History
books. If they come from Texas, forget it.
History books from Texas, I would say, will glorify the white Anglo-Saxon Protestant American settlers, European settlers,
mm-hmm.
who stole everything from the indigenous people and had slaves, kept slaves. They, mm-hmm. they're not going to glorify, they're not going to tell you the true story about what happened. You know, all I have to say is those white Europeans in Pennsylvania and I think Ohio, the Amish, I never heard about the Amish keeping slaves. They did the hard farm work themselves.
Yeah.
They worked their own farms. They weren't lazy Southern crackers. They're too fucking lazy to work their plantations. No, the Amish worked their farms.
I do question whether any 30-something person has the first-generation connection. Yeah, we read that. Holocaust survivors are dying out. The young men and women who witnessed the rise of the Nazis and fled are in their 90s. These survivors must be respected. Their loss was personal, not inclusive. And there was no grasp by the Trump administration that banning refugees on the same day the world paid homage to the dead of the Holocaust was also a statement that the Holocaust could happen again, that civilized societies were still capable of turning their back on people fleeing oppression and certain death because self-interest still trumps all other considerations. So, I looked for the healing from the president in Thursday's prayer breakfast speech, but it wasn't there. The Schwarzenegger joke should not be the only takeaway. It is most significant in that it shows how everything that happens in the world is, in Trump's eyes, all about him.
Why does he need to critique Arnold Schwarzenegger's job performance?
Because he has to.
Why?
His performance has to be better than Schwarzenegger's. He has to do that with the amount of people that were at the inauguration, with the winning popular vote. He has to be numero uno on everything.
Okay, does he honestly, maybe the American people's opinion of Donald Trump as a politician, maybe it carried over to those that watched Celebrity Apprentice in the past. Maybe their people are so angry with Donald Trump that they don't care about Celebrity Apprentice anymore. Maybe they have so much anger and disappointment that they decide not to watch Celebrity Apprentice.
Could be.
You can only go so far in firing people constantly. You know, eventually, you know, you're like, you know, fuck you. I'm fired, you know.
Further into his speech, Trump said he heard five words while campaigning that meant the most to him. I am praying for you.
Republicans like to say that, by the way.
Yeah.
I won't help you, but I'm praying for you.
Not I pray for a better world, or even I pray, but I am praying for you.
You.
Trump.
You, yeah.
Was the center of his speech.
Instead of praying for you, he should be living up to his campaign promises.
Rather than talk about the deep fear American Muslims have today after the travel ban and after a young white man shot worshippers in a mosque in Canada on Sunday, Trump singled out the elimination of the so-called Johnson Amendment, which prohibits tax-exempt churches from advocating for a political candidate as a top priority.
Well, they made it legal for the coal mining companies to dump their waste in rivers, in local rivers and streams.
Of course.
You know, the hell with the planet. Profit comes first, right?
That's right. Profit, you know, before people.
You know, what about the poor child born, a Mexican child that was born in the United States and raised in the United States, and then his mother gets deported? How would they react to that? But the rich Republicans can care less about those kids.
Freedom to worship without government intervention is a First Amendment right. No one should fear that praying in a church, a temple, or a mosque will get them on a government watch list. Freedom to campaign for a political candidate while also being exempt from paying taxes is not the same thing. Trump also cited the inclusion of under God in the Pledge of Allegiance as a sign that we are a nation that values God.
This is a nation that doesn't know a damn thing about the God of the Bible.
God isn't a word. Putting God in the pledge in 1954 didn't put God in anyone's heart or soul. It was a gesture to a communist-fearing America. And putting God into political speeches today is symbolic and nothing more. Trump is not shy about naming Islam every chance he gets when he talks about terrorism and barbarism. He did nothing Thursday to tell Americans they should not fear or hate Muslims. Just as he did nothing last week in his Holocaust statement to remind the world that the Holocaust was about Jewish genocide. Putting God into speeches is easy. Putting God into actions is not. Arnold Schwarzenegger's ratings should be the last thing on Trump's mind.
It's the least of his worries. With the crisis that he's up against of being president of the United States, he's worried about the ratings of Celebrity Apprentice?
Yes.
Where are his priorities?
Trump.
Oh, his ego, right?
They're on Trump, yes.
Well, that's why he's so preoccupied with the satire done by Saturday Night Live.
Oh, now he's after him, yeah.
Yeah, he's obviously that's more important than living up to his campaign promises.
Yep.
Working for the American people. What about is there anything there about this insane law that the Republicans want to allow police officers to shoot protesters like fascist stormtroopers?
They already have that right. What have they been doing for the last
protesters.
Couple of years?
I mean, well,
they got the right now to shoot you if your license plate is hanging. What the hell?
So they usually get away with that, right?
Absolutely.
When they blow somebody away because they feel like it. Well, how do they get away with blowing somebody away that's unarmed or that doesn't do anything wrong?
They do that too.
How the fuck did they get away with it?
Because the what do you call that? The big jury usually does not indict them because there is a fear that if these cops, rogue cops, are indicted, that other cops will not do their job.
Do their job, but blowing away someone who doesn't do anything wrong, it's not their job. It's their. In other words, unless we want chaos here in the United States,
we got it all.
Politicians, everyone is not above the law, or they shouldn't be above the law. No one. From the lowest, poorest, homeless person to the highest politician in the land, everybody should be held accountable according to the law.
Yeah.
Otherwise, you might as well call this the fascist states of America.
Well, that some people are doing it. What do you think Black Lives Matter is? It matters. Is all about.
Right, exactly.
And then there's their All Lives Matter, of course. You can't have rogue people in law enforcement, number one.
Now, well, look at the pipeline in, what is it, North Dakota?
Yeah.
The Sioux Indians, Lakota Sioux. Yeah. The oil company is claiming it's like 75 miles from Indian land, and you're telling me no, it's a lie.
No, they're saying it's going over sacred Indian land.
Somebody's lying.
It's usually the company.
Well,
because they have to get what they want.
Yeah. Well,
what they're
saying is a blatant in-your-face lie because it is.
But what did Kellyanne Conway do the other day? With alternative facts.
Oh, that?
Yeah, that. If you don't have somebody who is a fact checker, you get away with the propaganda. It's very simple.
Yeah.
And then you come out with what she said. Well, you have your facts and we have ours. You know? And then if you do have a fact checker, what they do to make that fact checker less accurate, they, you know, attack against it to make it less accurate, and then you don't believe that either. You'll believe their propaganda. You know, the woman justice?
Ginsburg? Ruth Bader Ginsburg?
No.
Kagan?
No, the statue.
Oh, the scales. The scales.
Well, that statue in Republican hands, the one scale is down, the other one is up.
In regards to the 1% oligarch,
correct.
It's imbalanced. There is no fair imbalance.
That is correct, sir. Ow! Ooh, ooh, ooh.
As much as William H. Morrow believes, the mainstream media, like CNN, is still fair and balanced. Case concerning Kellyanne Conway and Donald Trump, I do side, first time ever, with CNN. When the CNN representative got upset with Kellyanne Conway,
as well he is, he should.
You know, because you might as well. You're throwing their careers right into the abyss, you know, when they can't perform their journalism.
They destroyed Dan Rather.
Did he quit?
No, he was just.
He was old.
No, that had nothing to do with it.
I think he's doing something now.
Yeah, he is. He's coming back.
No, but he's coming back with a purpose.
Yeah.
He's pissed.
But the point is that they destroyed his integrity, and that's what they do.
How do you destroy the reputation of such a well-established man like Dan Rather?
Well, very easy.
Who did his job the old-fashioned way.
When you don't have a fact checker,
you're
at the mercy.
It's like he said, she said, right?
How did Senator McCarthy do it?
Because he felt like pointing his finger.
That's right. That's all he did. There was no facts to any of his nonsense that he blamed people for being communists, etc.
They put all Japanese Americans in the internment camps, right?
Yeah. Yes.
Oh, you were born here. You went to school here. But you're still Japanese. We're gonna stick you in a camp.
Donald Trump promised on Thursday that he would totally destroy the law that prohibits churches from engaging in political activity. A move that would upend 63 years of settled tax law. In an appearance at the annual National Prayer Breakfast, Trump said he would make good on his promise to overturn the Johnson Amendment, which bans public charities, including churches, from campaigning for or against a candidate for elected office.
Well, they have no business sticking their so-called religious nose into politics.
Well, he's going to get rid of that law, isn't he?
So he's going to try to combine evangelical right-wing church with state. What do you call that? Theocracy?
Yeah.
Fascism and theocracy. Theocratic.
Those that do risk losing their tax exemption. Among those freedoms is the right to worship according to our own beliefs. That is why I will get rid of and totally destroy the Johnson Amendment.
He says it like a fascist.
And allow our representatives of faith to speak freely and without fear of retribution. I will do that.
Well, they could I don't care if they express themselves, even though they sound like lunatics, but just don't apply anyone's religion to the law or making new laws.
You know? The statement was met by enthusiastic applause.
I mean, a perfect example. An evangelical saying, oh, the earth is only 6,000 years old, and there's no Big Bang theory, there's no evolution, there's no dot. Adam and Eve frolicked with the dinosaurs or some bullshit. You know, things like that, that you can't prove. That makes for a very crazy government that believes that. And cherry picking from the Old Testament.
The 1954 law is named for Senator Lyndon Johnson because it's in the tax code. Any change would have to come from Congress. Campaign watchdogs criticized Trump's call, saying it would open up another conduit for unlimited and anonymous money in elections. Religious groups can accept sums of any size and do not have to make public their donors' identities. This is a way to convert religious organizations, charities, and educational groups into dark money organizations. Allowing groups that are exempt from paying taxes to engage in political activity would force the government to subsidize secret money in politics.
Yeah.
The position is not a new one for Trump, who used it as a selling point to evangelical voters during his campaign. In a speech to the Values Voters Summit in Washington last September, Trump said, "The first thing we have to do is give our churches their voice back."
I thought they had their voice.
It's been taken away.
Hey, all those right-wing pastors, they haven't been censored.
They've been doing what they shouldn't have been doing for years.
They're all yapping their crap. Nobody's taking their voice away. Unfortunately, they're spewing their garbage way too much.
They spew their garbage, then they get it into law, and therefore it overlords the other laws that they consider down here.
What the hell is he talking? See, I don't understand why Donald Trump's kowtowing to them, because Donald Trump does not... He never
That's
made
correct.
It obvious that he was very religious at all.
That's correct.
Or an evangelical.
That's correct.
So all of a sudden he's cowtown to them.
That's his base.
What do you mean base?
35% of the Republican Party.
You mean all those freaks voted for him. So now he owes the freaks.
That is correct, sir.
Like, who was that, Rick James that sang "The Girl's a Super Freak"?
Super Freak.
The girl's a super freak. Dun, 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 dun. She's a very kinky girl.
Trump argued that the Johnson Amendment has restricted not just political speech, but religious speech as well. If they want to talk about Christianity, if they want to preach, if they want to talk about politics, they are unable to do so, he said. All religious leaders should be able to freely express their thoughts and feelings on religious matters.
What do you think?
What do you mean? It's not a think, it's the law. No!
No, not the reading.
Oh.
Not the reading, the break.
Oh, you get 5 minutes if you want it.
What, do you have a five minutes
small
thing to read?
Certainly, I got something small here.
You notice Stephen the cat, it frantically twitches his tail continuously?
Yes, he should have been named Twitchy.
Yeah, if he wasn't Steve, he would be Twitchy the cat. Because the other cats don't do that. It's all over the place. It's like he's got an electrical current going through his body.
How can the editorial writer make such a claim? From Puritan days to today's televangelists, politicians and educators have despised, harassed, and marginalized Roman Catholics. Catholic politicians shirk their faith in order to be compatible with a secular America. The historian Arthur Schlesinger Jr. wrote that anti-Catholicism has been the deepest held bias in the history of the American people.
Here's another idiot that wants to combine church and state.
When the Irish fled the potato famine in 1840s...
Speaking of potato, I will be making my own cotton beef and cabbage with boiled potato this March. But the little potatoes, the little ones.
They were met with violence, burning churches and signs reading, Irish need not apply.
Cotton beef and cabbage, yes.
One of the most flagrant violations of civil rights was the internment of 120,000 Japanese Americans during the World War III.
There you go.
And when a German ocean liner carrying 1,000 Jews tried to escape the Nazis, President Roosevelt turned them away.
President Roosevelt turned them away. He wasn't perfect.
Exactly. This is one of my examples of what I keep telling you. We all have a dark side.
Well, you know, Dr. Bill, back in the day, people were more racist.
Oh yeah.
More bigoted than they were than they are today.
Or since 1965. Yeah.
You know, like older generation folks, even nice people, use the word colored.
Mm-hmm.
Colored people.
Or the N word.
Well, the rap artists, they are
the only ones can use it.
They popularized that term, that derogatory term, in general language, which is not good to desensitize words like that. But getting back to the older folks, they use the word colored. I mean, they grew up with that. I mean. So, as far as the government goes, yeah, there's some skeletons in FDR's closet, and there's two of them. Japanese and Americans internment camp, and the 1,000 Jews that were seeking haven, safe haven.
I'm sure there are others.
And there might be others. I mean, you know.
Italians, Poles, and other nationalities face their own unwelcome. And lest we forget, Native Americans would either laugh or cry at the editorial's claim that America has long been a sanctuary for immigrants.
Yeah. Well, they remember how they came down on Paula Deen? Oh, Paula Deen is not a spring chicken, you know. She comes from a long past generation from this, I guess, Savannah, Georgia. And, you know, she's probably a nice woman, but you know, that's the language they use.
Yeah, well, that was it was just inculcated in them. It's just it's part of their character.
Yeah. Okay, we're gonna break for lunch.
Yeah.
And then you will be joined by our sensible sage, Sasch Boyle, and his words of wisdom, and then followed by promo. The how to defeat a conservative Bible verses. Hit the pause button, read and learn. And then we'll be back for the balance of the show.
Hey, how's everybody doing? All right, cool. All right, so last couple weeks, scalpers lost money at the Trump events. They're lying about the crowd size, lying at the press conference. Surprise, surprise. Alternative facts. Kellyanne Conway actually tried to get that past the media, saying that they don't believe in facts and they believe in alternative facts, which are basically lies. And Truck Todd, the tool, actually called her out on it. How about that? EPA hasn't looked at any lead levels, at least the guy that Trump wants to put in charge of the EPA. You know, Flint, what have you. And Flint's just the tip of the iceberg. Trump withdraws from the TPP, bans communications from government agencies like EPA, USDA. Some of them are already fighting back, putting up alternative Twitter accounts. So, awesome. Bannon, the white supremacist, is writing all of Emperor Trump's ongoing presidential decrees. It's kind of ridiculous if you look at this past week. Women's March was the biggest in history, went over 7 continents. It was pretty amazing. I saw it in San Francisco myself, and I was very impressed. Very impressed. People out hiking in the rain and trudging through, carrying those really impressive signs. There's some fun signs if you check them out. The Dems start to soften, then harden against Trump's picks. Looks like they're going to block the education person, this woman, I forget her name, and that's good. So they're caving to pressure from the public, from the constituency, which is good. They need to harden up and filibuster everything that comes out of the Trump administration. The ethics picks are a joke. One for Trump, fought to get money in politics, and the other one was the attorney for Trump U. So he's just trolling us at this point. Hillary wants to run again in 2020. The neoliberals still not getting it. We may even get Hillary TV. How about that? Eesh, it's just what we need, right? Hillary's a variety show. And the fascist states of America are beginning, not just Trump's presidential decrees, but Louisiana. They want to make resisting arrest a felony. And some states are trying to make it a felony to even protest. So this fascist crap, getting rid of our civil liberties is happening. And we got to stop it. All right, that was fast, but it was the last couple of weeks. Short but sweet, uncensored, hard-hitting truth coming at you. California, peace.
Greetings. This is James P. Madonna of Megalife 21 Hard Hitting Podcasts, Holistic Health Talk, and Progressive Discussions. I want to talk about the very foundation of our entire organization, the newsletter that was founded by my co-host and mentor, the Reverend Dr. William J. Eisenman, in 1977. And that newsletter is called Censored. Newsletter Censored is truth and news fighting censorship and conservative propaganda. We believe we are living in the end times, and you need Newsletter Censored. Newsletter censor provides the kind of truth that most people are afraid to hear. Can you handle it? Newsletter Censored is for the independent, critical, free thinker with an open mind. Besides the reading of Censored, Newsletter Censored also has The God Project and How to Defeat a Conservative. There is nothing in the mainstream media or the press like Newsletter Censored. So simply go to www.newslettercensored.com and with your gift to support this work, get your free annual subscription to the newsletter that started it all in 1977, Newsletter Censored. You need Newsletter Censored. That's www.newslettercensored.com. Greetings. This is James P. Madonna of Megalife 21 Hard-Hitting Podcasts, Holistic Health Talk, and Progressive Discussions. I want to talk about the very foundation of our entire organization, the newsletter that was founded by my co-host and mentor, the Reverend Dr. William J. Eisenman, in 1977. And that newsletter is called Censored. Newsletter Censored is truth and news, fighting censorship and conservative propaganda. We believe we are living in the end times, and you need Newsletter Censored. Newsletter Censored provides the kind of truth that most people are afraid to hear. Can you handle it? Newsletter Censored is for the independent, critical, free thinker with an open mind. Besides the reading of Censored, Newsletter Censored also has The God Project and How to Defeat a Conservative. There is nothing in the mainstream media or the press like Newsletter Censored. So simply go to www.newslettercensored.com and with your gift to support this work, get your free annual subscription to the newsletter that started it all in 1977, Newsletter Censored. You need Newsletter Censored. That's www.newslettercensored.com.
Okay, we are back.
Jack. Thank you, sensible sage Sasch Boyle, for your commentary. And we're back for the remainder of this show, Progressive Discussions. Gotta love it. Being sarcastic. Go
ahead. The country's bacon reserves.
Oh, I love bacon.
Are at the lowest levels in a half a century.
Well, that's a real crisis.
In other words, pig farmers can't keep up with the world's sizzling appetite for those fatty, smoky strips.
Well, there's only one section on every pig where you can get bacon from.
Belly.
It's like chicken wings. It's like the buffalo wings that guys like to eat during football games.
You know, there's only tomorrow.
Yeah, Super Bowl Sunday. There's only two wings on every chicken. So you need to kill a lot of chickens to get all those wings. Could you imagine how many chickens have to be dispatched? So, you know, have a little consideration for the pig farmers, you know? All right, go ahead.
The Ohio Pork Council, a nonprofit based in Columbus, reported on Tuesday that the demand for frozen pork belly, frequently made into bacon,
that is true,
is outpacing the supply.
In Spanish, in Latin America, they call it chicharrón.
Today's pig farmers are setting historic records by producing more pigs than ever. Yet our reserves are still depleting.
That's not good. That's not good, man.
There are literally not enough little piggies going to market.
We need more. We need more pig farms. Or hopefully organic.
In December, frozen pork belly inventory totaled 17.8 million pounds. The lowest level since 1957.
Hey, a lot of methane gas. You know how much, what do they call it, ethanol, you know how much natural gas can be created from pig fecal matter? There are tons and tons of pig fecal matter produced by these farms.
According to the United States Department of Agriculture, as a result, prices are on the rise.
Oh, gee.
The council reports pork belly prices increased 20% in January.
Yeah, they always use that supply and demand mumbo jumbo as an excuse to raise the prices.
Officials said, increased foreign demand might account for the decline in inventory.
Hey, pigs like chickens could be raised just about anywhere in the world. What problem do they have in other countries? They have plenty of pigs there, as well as chickens.
Hog farmers export approximately 26% of their total production.
Hey, I trust livestock from other countries. At least you know there's a good chance that they're organically raised.
While bacon may become more expensive for consumers, rest assured, pork industry will not run out of supply.
Yeah. Oh, they're always cry me a river. When big business cries the blues, cry me a river. You know the buffets in Las Vegas, when the food gets all passé and mushy, they won't donate that to the soup kitchens. Food, they sell it to the pig farmers in Nevada.
Yeah.
Feed the hogs.
Yep.
Boss hog. Yeah.
In the article. About President Hedges' on idea of 20% border tax, it is pointed out that it will cost upwards of $15 billion to initially build the wasteful and useless wall.
This is a good reading.
This will be paid first by the United States taxpayer.
Of course.
Only to be repaid by a proposed 20% tax on all imports from Mexico. This tax would be added to the cost of all items from Mexico.
Hey, my hot sauce.
From beer to clothing.
My hot sauce that I buy all the time. The big giant bottle of hot sauce is gonna go up in price. That's not fair.
This tax would be added to the cost of all items from Mexico, from beer to clothing, that are sold in America.
Modelo. The Modelo Beer Company who makes Corona and all the other beers will be Well, they're already overpriced anyway. If you go to a bar and order one, maybe in the liquor store, they'll be jacked up.
So citizens of the United States would pay more to cover Trump's $15 billion war. This brings the total cost to American workers and citizens for the wall to be $30 billion.
Yeah, because Republicans really like to put the blame on immigrants of color. Like, that's not where the real problem is for the United States economy. That really is not the root of it. The real problem is there's a lack of revenue from the rich people not paying their taxes. That's the number one problem.
The only way this useless wall gets built is with taxpayer dollars. And that will cause hardship for the average American.
Meaning the middle class. Always that middle class they have to attack. Of course, there's a war on the poor, too.
A letter writer suggests that editorial page writer Alfred P. Doblin craft an entire column about the good that President Trump has said and done. The letter writer goes on to suggest that such a column might be and might win a Pulitzer surprise.
Yeah.
In the fiction category.
Pulitzer Prize.
In the fiction category.
In the fiction category, right.
Yeah. The lexicon of emotional but meaningless words and phrases are now part of Americana, right to work. Laws never gave anyone a job. We now add sanctuary city without a definition of sanctuary. Is it a city with many immigrants? Thus, a letter writer can claim new voter restrictions are no problem, as 75% of those 65 or older have a driver's license. This only eliminates one of every four senior citizens from voting. It is also claimed that 55% of Americans are veterans. Amazing. As in World War II, only 9% of Americans served. We are in an alternate facts world.
We're in an insane asylum of a world.
Yeah.
Well, no, we're in an insane asylum of a United States of America.
Yeah, and the inmates are in charge. They're in charge, baby.
Oh, yeah. Oh, without a doubt. I really thought Donald Trump was much more intelligent than this. What he's been doing with his cabinet selections. And I knew something was strange when he picked Pence as his vice presidential running mate, the religious freak.
Cowtowing to those evangelicals.
Maybe he chose douchebag Pence to appeal.
Of course.
Be more appealing to the evangelical freaks out there in the southern and western states of America.
Of course.
America. I don't know why they call them Bible Belt states, because you have to know the Bible to be called a Bible Belt state.
Because they take it out and thump it.
They shake it around.
In your face.
They thump it. They don't know the contents of it.
That is correct, but they get the... What do you call it? They get the camera. Because they're thumping and shaking.
You know, if we didn't have so many readings, we could probably easily do a show on Bible study revelation. Reading the real truth from the Bible.
Yeah, but what would that do to the people?
Exposing those scumbags. Exposing them, Dr. Bill.
Exactly, but that will bring none of them to the Bible.
Well, we can call them names. We can call...
To a powerful person is not the answer. Because it won't get you where you want to go.
They don't know the Bible, so how can they profess to be real Christians?
I'm not against that. I'm saying that it will not bring them over.
Oh, it's kind of like the the teabaggers I know that are like lower middle class, and when I tell them about what Ronald Reagan did, and when I tell them about how all the burden is on the backs of the middle class, they just stare at me. They don't like agree with me.
No, because they don't know anything about it.
They don't have an opinion. All they know is flag waving. That. You know what I mean? And all this phony baloney patriotism and phony Christianity.
It is correct. How else can you explain Wolf County in Kentucky? How else can you explain?
Hey, you know something? Let me use something comical and very light-hearted as an example. Remember All in the Family?
Yeah.
Remember how the meathead Mike Stivic could never get through to Archie Bunker?
Exactly.
I don't think he ever really got through to Archie Bunker.
No, he didn't. They settled in the end for emotion.
Well, they moved to Minnesota.
Well, they moved next door. Then they moved again?
Yeah, they. Mike Stivic.
Mike and Sally moved next door.
Mike Stivic, after.
To the Jeffersons.
After Little Goyle, Sally Struthers. Well, no, she's not so little anymore.
Had the baby.
Well, no, she got fat, unless she lost the weight. But anyway, Rob Reiner, the meathead and his wife, after they moved next door, Mike got a job offer to teach at a university in Minnesota. So the baby, I think it was little Joey, I think, the baby and his daughter and son-in-law moved to Minnesota. And then that's when George Jefferson and Wheezy moved in. But...
Moved in where?
Next door to Archie Bunker.
They were there first. Stivic bought the house from the Jeffersons.
Oh, yeah, you're right. Lionel used to come over all the time.
Right.
Yeah. Okay, all right, I'm sorry. George Jefferson, his business grew. He sold the house to Mike. To Meathead. He moved up to the east side to the deluxe apartment in the sky. Fish don't fry in the kitchen. Beans. How could beans cook on a grill? Anyway, I digress. Anyway, then eventually, Mike took the job in Minnesota. But what I'm saying is, because I really digressed, the Meathead never got through to Archibald Bunker, who wasn't a well-off, financially independent person to be a Republican. He didn't get through to him in all those years. Never got through to him.
Yeah.
That's the point I was getting at.
Yep.
I know it. He started singing theme songs. I started singing theme songs, and we got off track a little bit.
If this is what running government like a business looks like...
Oh, gee.
It's no wonder President Donald Trump's companies kept going bankrupt.
And how is he such an expert on Celebrity Apprentice if his companies keep on going bankrupt? So he's like the expert on running a business then, right?
Yeah, he claims to be.
But if you go bankrupt all the time, isn't that running a business into the ground?
Yeah, but then you can, like he does, for the last 18 years, claim that as a loss, and you don't have to pay taxes.
And if you don't like the work somebody did for you, you refuse to pay them. You stiff him.
Stick him, man.
I don't particularly care for the job you did on the Trump Taj Mahal. I have a problem with the quality of work that you did, so therefore I'm not going to pay you.
There you go.
Yeah.
1 week into the presidency, we've gotten a taste of Trump's management style. And so far, it's been plagued by many of the bad habits common to poorly run businesses. Take, for example, his administration's clear indifference to, or outright rejection, of good measurement and analytics. One of the first things you learn from talking to management experts and successful entrepreneurs is the importance of having a clear set of objectives as determining whether those objectives have been met, or as Trump's Commerce Secretary nominee Wilbur Ross,
that was the owner of Mr. Ed.
Wilbur Ross argued not once but twice in his confirmation hearing last week. I have a very heartfelt saying in management that anything you can't measure, you cannot manage. Ross, arguably the most business savvy of Trump's cabinet picks, has not yet been confirmed. In his absence, the administration has not exactly been taking his heartfelt saying to heart. During a January 23rd news conference, while House Press Secretary Sean Spicer refused to answer a simple measurement question, what is the current unemployment rate? The answer is not exactly a secret. Earlier this month, the Labor Department publicly announced its latest reading as 4.7%.
That's not the real answer is perhaps a secret.
But Spicer, whose boss has variously claimed the rate is a total fiction and as high as 42%, ducked. Instead of providing the figure or citing an alternative metrics he thought could be better gauges of economic health, such as measures of under unemployment or labor force participation, Spicer poo-pooed interest in quantitative gauges altogether. The president, he's not focused on statistics as much as he is on whether or not the American people are doing better as a whole. Spicer said. He went on to admonish Washington for fixating on numbers and forgetting the faces and families and the businesses that are behind those numbers. Bully for Trump! For caring about helping real people! People with faces rather than statistics! But numbers are the best tool we have for assessing whether the administration actually lives up to its promise to make sure the American people are doing better as a whole. If you pulled this kind of stunt in business, arguing that, say, growth targets or other quantifiable metrics don't matter, and only some ineffable sensation of success does, you'd probably fail. With Ross as a possible exception, Trump's personnel decisions also bear many of the hallmarks of badly run companies. He's made hiring decisions based not necessarily on qualifications or experience, but on whether candidates are members of his family or have the right look. Funny facial hair, inadequate height, absence of a swagger reportedly disqualifies some contenders. He's likewise instituted an indefinite across-the-board hiring freeze, despite the fact that the federal government has clearly identifiable crucial needs for staffing up in select areas, including for 2017 economic census and preparations for the 2020 census. Not to mention that a government accountability office analysis of across-the-board hiring freezes implemented by earlier presidents found that the resulting agency disruptions increased costs to the taxpayers, and in the long run, targeted freezes and cuts, the report said, are more effective. Addressing bureaucratic bloat with a chainsaw rather than a scalpel isn't leadership, it's laziness. Yet that's how his administration has thus far approached regulation. Rather than thoughtfully assessing rules and regulations coming down. The pike, by conducting a cost-benefit analysis, as you might in a real business, Trump halted them across the board. They include one related to keeping airplanes from crashing. It's about inspecting aircraft fuselages for cracks. Finally, Trump has recently committed to spending billions of dollars on pet projects that are essentially expensive solutions to problems that don't exist. A border wall with Mexico. Despite the fact that we've seen a net outflow of unauthorized Mexican immigrants in recent years. And voter fraud investigation into millions of illegal votes that he believes with zero evidence were cast in the election he won. Again, hard to imagine that such costly, low upside executive windmill chasing would fly at a competitive business. Needless to say, there are major differences between running a business and running a government. It is a myth that aptitude at one necessarily translates to aptitude at the other. But with ineptitude, maybe it's a different story.
Sure. Really bizarre world in the United States today. Real bizarre world. When is the groundhog supposed to come out?
It's already out.
What did it do?
February 2. Punxsutawney Phil.
What did Punxsutawney do?
Saw his shadow, which means 6 more weeks of winter.
So that's
Staten Island Chuck. Who was actually a female.
What did it do?
Did not see his shadow. And says we will have an early spring.
Is Punxsutawney Phil geriatric? Is he old, or do they keep on replacing him when they croak? When the woodchucks die, they get another Punxsutawney Phil, right?
Well, but for the time being, Punxsutawney Phil is the qualified one.
So we have a male woodchuck,
yes,
and a female woodchuck.
Correct.
And the male says more winter.
Correct.
And the female says an early spring.
Correct.
Interesting. Very interesting. Got one more for the road.
Why don't we have one of the old
change of paste?
Change of paste.
Tomato paste.
Yeah.
All right.
Because I'm building up a couple of those with all these Trumpy here.
Yeah, we're. Yeah, it's enough. That's enough for him.
Let's see what I got here.
I'm sure the liquor companies are making money hand over fist with Trump and the Republicans being in control.
You know, Why?
Driving people to drink more?
Oh.
For the stress?
All right, yeah.
For the stress?
Yeah.
Smoke, unfortunately, cigarette companies, which I cannot stand that filthy habit. And it's also a killer.
This is Amy Dickinson. Dear Amy, I have been with my boyfriend for 2 years. We are both in our mid-20s. One of the things that I am increasingly bothered by is our differing attitudes towards gift giving.
Okay.
I grew up in a family that threw huge Christmases that's centered on gifts.
Oh, she's a materialistic bitch.
Though that sounds vain and superficial.
Yes, it is.
The exchange of gifts is a very meaningful tradition to me.
Yeah, especially when she receives them.
My siblings scoping out and making the perfect gifts for each other.
Let me tell you something.
For Christmas.
Retail would love more families like that. Retail industry.
When the day comes, the best part is not opening your own gifts, but watching with glee as the others open gifts you gave them.
She's just a sucker to retail.
On the other hand, my boyfriend grew up with very stingy parents who sometimes do not even acknowledge his birthday.
Oh, that sucks.
This was not for financial reasons,
it's the opposite.
Because of their minimalist values.
That's the total opposite of her family.
Needless to say, he doesn't really understand my desire to exchange gifts.
Well, honoring birthdays is kind of like egomaniacal, right? Selfish.
Our entire relationship, I have not once received so much as a birthday card from him. I was a little heartbroken to realize
another racket
that when we got together to exchange Christmas gifts this year, the gift that I spent weeks making for him was countered with, "Your present is that you're really going to get good sex tonight."
Yeah, you can put a red ribbon around his genitals. Yeah. And the greeting card company is another racket. Nobody talks like that anymore. Oh, darling. Oh, yeah, come on, give me a break. Hey, honey, you're gonna get really good sex tonight. Look at the red ribbon I got around my balls.
I'm not asking for anything, sir. I would utterly cherish something as simple.
Levity buzz.
As a handwritten love letter.
Hand job? Something is, a handwritten love letter.
Should I just try to let it go?
Well, he's not expressing, maybe she needs reassurance that he loves her. Maybe he doesn't, he takes her for granted. Instead of granite. Oh.
Speaking of Christmas, this is Amy's answer. At this past year's celebration in my huge family, several of the young adults were talking about the book, The Five Love Languages, The Secret to Love That Lasts, by Gary Chapman, which had been making the rounds through the family. The His book was first published in 1992 and now updated with many different editions. Hal finds how differently people perceive ways to give and receive love. Chapman says an individual's love language is based on temperament and also how the person was raised. You and your boyfriend are giving each other the gifts you would like most to receive. If you received anything handmade from him, your love would tank, would be full. You would feel honored and appreciative.
Well, people like to be reassured that their significant other still cares. We can't neglect each other either.
His gift idea also indicates how you might fill his love tank. If he wants you to be happy in your relationship, he will have to figure out how to make the simple gestures that you treasure, and vice versa. Who knows? Really good sex might follow.
Well, I don't think it's so much in the sex act. I think it's how he treats her in general. You know, what he says to her verbally, I think that's what's important. Doing things together, spending quality time together. Not so much in the materialism of gift giving, because what happens is when people receive gifts constantly, you know what happens? You know what they end up doing? They have a lot of garage sales across the nation every summer.
Uh-huh.
Because that's how you end up with a lot of shit building up in your basements, in your garages, in your attics. And just for the sake of giving a gift, I mean, things will build up. You'll have clutter everywhere. I think what's more important is quality time spent together and how each other is treated. That's all. I know I sound like Jerry Springer. Jerry Springer's last words of wisdom, you know, but that's how I see it. It's not in the material possession. Hell, rich people show their love to their children who are raised by the nannies. They think it's love to buy them everything they want, to buy them expensive gifts all the time. And but there's no interaction. There's no quality time spent. The nanny does everything.
Nanny go.
So the rich kid is raised by the nanny. And there's no real love being showed by the biological parents. So we did enough politics today. I think it was quite sufficient. So Arnold Schwarzenegger, don't worry about the criticism coming from Donald Trump.
Don't worry about ratings.
You know, I mean, I think people just grew weary of the words "you're fired," because I think they're getting an overdose of Trump, as it is, and
that would seem logical.
Yeah, and you know, the people on Celebrity Apprentice, let me tell you, I've never seen so much backstabbing cattiness in my life. One of the worst catty, vicious backstabber was this comedian, very ugly woman, this comedian by the name of Lisa Lampanelli.
Oh.
And she made many enemies. Nobody, people couldn't, the other women, even the guys couldn't stand her. She would complain profusely about the job performance of everybody. I think she was sucking up to Donald Trump by being
being
the overbearing
assistant,
the overbearing authority figure, the manager of the group, the manager, supervisor of the group. She was over, she was trying to keep herself out of the bullseye of being fired, and overcompensating for anything. It's like a looketh over there, like when the Republicans do something to distract you from what they're doing. Well, playing a big violin, trying to act like you're the most devoted, most dedicated, hardest working manager that you can ever have, by constantly tearing apart your team, you know, and it's kind of like a distraction from your job performance and what you are contributing, besides browbeating and criticizing and tearing apart your employees. Mm-hmm. So that's the it ended up to be very petty on that show, and I mean, I don't know. I just totally lost interest after a while.
Well, maybe a lot of other people did too.
People being mistreated in the corporate environment.
Yeah.
You know. But anyway, listen. Thank you for joining us for Progressive Discussions. We'll see you next time. I think the next week will be our St. Valentine's Day Massacre on our wallets show, because it will be the show before another retail scam. Valentine's Day.
Or afterwards.
The florists, the candy companies that make chocolates, the greeting cards companies, restaurants, and fine jewelry, the biggest scam of all on Valentine's Day. Fine jewelry with the bullshit Levion chocolate diamonds.
Can you eat them?
Sold by Jared. No, you better not. You'll break your teeth. Chocolate my ass. I bet they are the cheapest diamonds. There are so many brown diamonds coming out of, let's say, South Africa. The Beers Diamond Mining Company. There are so many of them coming out. They're so plentiful. They're not even precious stones. And in order to get rid of them, in order for the sleazy retail fine jewelry people to get rid of them, they decided, hey, they're brown, let's call them chocolate diamonds. Uh-huh. Oh, the women will love that word. Yeah. Chocolate diamonds. Ooh, you know, it's a waste of money. You're a sucker, man. You're an idiot for getting excited over fine jewelry.
Number one.
And the person who buys it is an idiot and a sucker, because it's not an investment. The diamond, they're too plentiful. It's not the precious stone it used to be. Mm. And unless you have a certified perfect stone, it's not an investment, you know? By the Gemological Institute of America, certified flawless. We'll see you next time. But I know a lot of you suckers that usually go along to get along, and they go through the motions, and they just gotta do what's expected of them during all these man-made traditional holidays that are made for businesses to make money. They'll continue to be suckers. All right, goodbye. Bye, suckers.
This has been a Megalife 21 production.